My husband now is younger than me.
Yeah.
Quite a bit younger than me.
Okay.
He's of a different religion altogether. He's Jewish. I'm Christian.
Yeah. How does that work?
It works.
Cool.
You know, it works. And I'll tell you, he's so open in the sense of, I was just telling Jen in the car, I needed someone to pray with yesterday. There's something going on and I needed prayer. And I'm thinking, who am I going to pray with? Who am I going to pray with? And I looked at him last night and I said, I know this is probably outside your comfort zone.
Right.
Because he's not a religious person at all.
Yeah.
I said, but I need you to pray with me.
Yeah.
And he's like, I can do that. And I'm like, okay. So then just before bed, you know, all three of us, Nico, Mike, and I held hands and I said the prayer. At the end, they were looked at me and they're like, amen.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was so cute, you know.
But that is respect, cute.
Right? Absolutely. Yeah. You know, respect and empathy. And yeah. He just gets me. I can wind myself up fairly easily, and he just has this calming. He just knows how to.
Do you get some anxiety?
I do.
You do.
Absolutely.
Do you think that's because of the PTSD, or do you think that's a separate thing that's just kind of developed?
I think I likely had it before.
Yeah.
I think it's probably progressed because of the PTSD, but I think there was always. A bit of it. I know I will catch myself if I'm in a meeting or something. I will catch myself biting the side of my cheek.
Yeah.
And I didn't know what it was for the longest time until somebody said, oh, that's anxiety.
Yeah,
that's
sure.
That's anxiety. And I'm like, really?
Yeah.
You know, so, or, you know, touching something or,
yeah.
You know, it's a comforting, I'm trying to soothe myself on a subconscious level.
Exactly.
Without even realizing.
Yeah, exactly.
It.
For sure. And we all typically have
something.
Yeah. That we aren't aware of or whatever. I mean, now that I've had this beard, sometimes I'll catch myself like that. Right. I'm like, okay, I know what that is.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Yeah.
How do you find dealing with the PTSD and the anxiety? Do you do it naturally or do you take medication or?
I took no medication ever. I'm not a believer of medication unless I absolutely have to. So with anxiety or PTSD, no, I didn't take anything.
Yeah.
My father actually said something to me when I was going through one of my rough patches. He said to me, he used to say it to me often, and I didn't see it at the time, but he would say to me, you know, you don't realize how strong you are.
Yeah.
And I said, like, I just look at him. He said, you know, you've gone through everything. You don't drink. You don't smoke. You don't gamble. You've done nothing. You know, you're not taking any medication. You're just handling.
Yeah.
You're just dealing. And yeah. I'm just looking at him like, but he's right.
Yeah.
I mean, I very, very much could have turned to something addictive.
Sure. Yeah,
right?
Absolutely.
I could have, and I didn't. You know, I didn't turn to alcohol.
You've also built up your support system, too.
Yes, absolutely. And you know, counseling was not beneath me at all.
Mm-hmm.
I did have my fair share of counseling one-on-one, and like I said, with the group. And the group session actually was quite intense. It wasn't open to the general public. It was something that you had to be interviewed for, you had to apply for. It was quite a rigorous process to even be accepted.
So this is, explain to me what the group system is that you're talking
about. So what it is other people who have gone through other traumatic experiences.
All kind of get together.
All get together.
Is this a support group in a way?
It was at the hospital. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And so it was a support group and it just helps you be aware of it. It helps you recognize triggers because what would happen to me, I didn't even realize I had it until it finally hit me, right? I was working at a company at the time when I was going through this rough patch and my manager at the time said to me, you know, because I said to her, you know, I'm fine, I'll be back to work tomorrow. And she's like, no, take time off. And I'm like, no, I'm fine. She's like, take time off and deal with it.
Right.
And I, you know, was afraid of losing my job. I'm like, no. And she had mentioned the word PTSD to me at the time.
Yeah.
And I didn't understand it until later. And it hit me like a brick wall.
Really?
So what it is you deal with whatever you have to deal with at the time.
Yeah.
And your body instinctively kicks into survival mode.
Yeah.
So you just function
yeah.
and like my counselor at the time told me, it's like you put your emotions in a backpack.
Mm-hmm.
So any emotions that you should deal with go in the backpack and you
they
don't
come
deal
up later.
With them. They come up later.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happened.
Yeah.
What would happen is I remember at one point I was living with my parents. This is how bad it was. I was living with my parents. And, you know, I would leave to go to work every day at 6:30 in the morning, and I'd wake my dad up to walk me to the car, which was right there in the driveway.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
I was like, please, can you just come with me, please?
Is that because you were scared?
Yes.
What were you scared of?
further attacks, that somebody might be around the corner, somebody's waiting for me.
All from this relationship mostly, you think? Really?
Not, and I'm sure that they would, again, right, I think it started from the childhood, right? I think it sort of all crept up and presented itself. And you know, at any point in time, if somebody sort of would go behind me and like, I would like jump. Like it wasn't just like, oh, you know, it was like, I would like, it would fly off the handle because my body just instinctively responded that way.
Right.
It just, your body just reacts in a way that you can't control.
Right.
So it was therapy was very interesting because you literally had to, what they wanted you to do was relive the situation utilizing your different senses.
Really?
Yes, and so that's how you get over it.
So how did you, explain to me how that works for you.
So, you know, so she would say to me, you know, go back to the night it happened. And she would say, okay,
we're
close
talking
your
about
eyes.
Physical abuse,
right? Yeah. So go back to the night it happened and, you know, close your eyes and listen to everything that was happening at the time. Walk through it step by step in your head and listen to everything. Listen. So I had to really use my listening sense. And then it was, you know, feel, you know, go back and feel everything. Look at, you know, feel this, feel that. What do you feel? What do you see, right? Then it was more the visual. What do you see? What do you see on his face? What do you see here? So you literally had to relive it
through each sense.
If that in itself, like the whole reliving it was, it's like, I don't want to go back.
Yeah,
I don't want to relive it. And she said, no, you have to get
why
it back.
Why
I think it's just putting closure. I think it's just sort of, you're trying to recognize what your triggers are. So you're reliving it. You're sort of closing your eyes and, you know, what do you see? I see the chair broken or something. And, you know, okay, well, maybe that's a trigger. Like, so they're trying to figure out what those triggers are.
Okay.
What do you hear? I hear somebody screaming in the background, you know.
So that might be why you're jumping.
Yes, you know, you get a grasp, you get an idea of what your triggers are, and then when you are aware of them, then you can control it.
Then you can say, oh, that's just a trigger that I have.
That's
from
a
that
trigger.
Time.
Why is my heart racing? Like every so often now, I'll be like, my heart's racing. Why is my heart racing?
Right.
Deep breath. Why is my heart racing?
Right.
What am I worried about? You know, so it's checking in with yourself.
I see. That's interesting because I was trying to see when you're talking about that, I'm thinking, how is going back and reliving these experiences going to help you in the future?
Move forward.
I just, you know, it's one of those things where living in the past, right?
Yes.
How do you, but I get it, especially if you can catch yourself. It's all about catching yourself.
Being aware.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Self-awareness is huge,
yeah,
right? This
yeah.
getting past anything.
Exactly.
You know the triggers, then you can learn how to cope with them.
Right.
Absolutely, yeah. So, again, a big driving factor of why we do what we do and, you know, what Jen, you know, does in her professional life, what I do in my professional life, I mean, it sort of drives us to help people. I mean, even in my Monday to Friday job, I'm an HR professional, and so my whole thing is about helping people succeed, so I, as much as I look at my past and say, oh, it shaped me to who I am today, I'm a better HR professional because of it, I'm a better image coach because of it. I can relate with people. I can empathize with them. When somebody comes to my office and says, you know, my marriage is breaking down. I understand.
Right.
You know, so it gives you this empathy that perhaps others struggle with.
I agree. And I think that when you said that you were broken going into that first marriage.
Yeah, I was.
But I think that everybody is broken.
You think so?
To some extent, I don't think anybody has the perfect life where there isn't an experience that really fucked them up, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
And whether they realize it or not, the fact that you realize it and you're working through it and that you can sort of relate to other people and put yourself in their shoes, that's probably why that happened to you. I think that the whole idea and the whole reason we become these broken people is to explore that and to help others cope with what they're going through if it's relatable.
Exactly.
So on that note, I mean, I think we all have our baggage. I don't think anybody that says they're not broken is a liar, really, or just not self-aware and they don't realize it, you know, or maybe they're just suppressing it somewhere.
Well, they say everyone has a story, right? I do believe everybody does have a story, and for the longest time, I didn't want to share it. I couldn't share it. I didn't want to.
What do you think was stopping you from doing that? Was it the general stigma of what people would think?
I think so. I mean, even Jen was speaking at Mo Mondays there a couple weeks ago, and we went to support her, and the host there was saying, you know, we're looking for speakers, and Jen's like, hey, Jen, I'm not ready to share my story. I don't know if I'm still part of me still ashamed. I mean, I think that people look at me now and go, you know, you were married for how long to a guy that did what? Like, I can't, and many times people will say, I can't imagine that you were, that you were in that and you tolerate, like, because it's, so it's embarrassing. So part of me is a little bit embarrassed to, to admit it, maybe.
But it's not who you are now?
No, it's not who I am now. Yeah. And, you know, again, you marry for life. You know, you really, the one thing I did learn, though, is, and I remember saying this to him, and it broke him when I told him, was, love's not enough.
I think I've said that as well.
It's not enough. You know, as I was leaving there the last time, I remember looking at him and going, you know, I love you, but it's not enough.
Yeah.
He couldn't fathom that. He's like, what do you mean? Like, we can make this work. And I'm like, it's not enough. I wish it was enough, but it really isn't.
What do you think was needed now that you look back? Do you really think it was love?
What's that?
Like this,
did you love him? I did.
So what do you think it was that you needed that wasn't enough? What was lacking?
You know, if I were sort of a rewind, and I think I mentioned it earlier, I needed to set healthy boundaries. You know, at one point he said to me, well, if you told me, you know, that you would leave me if I did this, then I wouldn't have done it. And I'm like, okay, isn't that just common sense? Right? So I don't know, did I need to be more firm right at the beginning? Like, I can remember being, you know, 18, and we were in the car just talking, and I don't know, he lost his temper on something, and he just punched that steering wheel.
Right.
And I just...
So he has an anger issue.
Oh, yeah. So I was just like, I'm just standing there kind of going... And then it was quiet, and then, you know, 30 seconds later, he'd be like, got you, he's joking! And I'm like...
Oh, really?
Okay. Oh, no, it's a joke! Okay! Until it wasn't.
Right.
So, you know, that went on for a number of years until I realized, no, actually, it's not a joke. So,
wow.
I didn't set those healthy boundaries. I probably should have said, yeah, that's not a joke.
Yeah.
That's not funny. That needs to stop now.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I didn't, you know, and I feel like if I was more secure, again, it's that insecurity, right? If I was more secure in myself and had the self-esteem, I could be strong enough to say, no, you can't talk to me like that. But again, this is the girl that thought she was never going to get married.
Right.
So the fact that an older guy was goo goo gaga over her.
Right. Do you think the age might have played a role in that as well? The fact that he was a little bit older may have been a little more intimidating to step up to?
No, I don't think so. No? I don't think age wasn't... No, I don't think so. I don't think that was a factor for me. I think it was just the boundaries. I didn't set boundaries, and I was determined to make it work.
Right.
I loved him so much. Right. It was going to work.
Right.
I wonder if part of it was that you were looking for someone to be your protector.
Yeah.
And then when you discovered, when it clicked in your head, he's not protecting me, he's hurting me.
Yeah.
Like, it was like, okay, that's enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure, could be. Yeah. Yeah, there's lots to think about. I mean, there's, love isn't enough. There's a lot more in making a relationship successful.
Right.
I was determined it was love, but it's not.
It sounds like it was a bit, not just love, but toxic love in a sense.
It was toxic. Again, on both sides.
Sure.
I don't want to paint him as this animal.
Of course not.
I had my fair share of issues as well. You need a lot more than just love to make a relationship work, for sure. And it's funny because when I met my now husband, it's a funny story because, again, I was so hurt, right?
Yeah.
Coming out of this marriage
that...
I had worked with him in the past, but he was in a different location. So he was in Montreal and I was in our London office. So I knew of him, but we weren't dating or anything at the time. So finally, when we decided we were going to date, I said to him, you know, when he said, look, I think we should go out on a date. And I'm like, really? Why is that? You know, and he's like, because I want to go on a date. Why do you want to go on a date?
That's what he was saying to you?
I was saying,
you were saying that to him.
I'm in the gears, right?
Okay, I see.
I'm like, if this is your idea of having a fling with an older woman, you're barking up the wrong tree. Like,
wow.
I was just
But that's awesome.
Right? But yeah. Again, I was talking from a place of fear. I mean, he thought it was great. He thought himself, wow, this woman knows what she wants, you know?
Yeah.
So to me, you know, if I'm going to be another, you know, notch on your belt.
So at first you kind of were a little defensive.
Very. What are your intentions?
More than a little, yeah.
Yeah.